so they know whether their children can start school on Monday. So I just pray that you will consider this and that I will be able to get some of these kids back. In fact, one of them, we only need $100 a month more. So thank you for considering this.
Our next announcement will be brought to us by video.
Hey, my name is Pastor Jeremy, and I'm the director of Way Ministries.
My name is Chaffee Brooke Wong, and I'm the director of Walk Ministries.
As you can see, we're very excited for our Chapter 2 launch party.
We hope that you'll be here on August 19th. We've got lots of fun resources and ways that your kids can get involved. There will also be lots of information to give you as well.
And we're going to have a lot of free stuff to give away, because who doesn't like free stuff? Yay!
Please mark your calendars, August 19th. We certainly hope to see you there.
Bye-bye!
August 19 is going to be very special. We hope that you are going to join us on that day. Not only do we have the Chapter 2 launch party going on, but we've got a women's prayer breakfast. And ladies, it is not too late. You can still sign up for the prayer breakfast there on their own table. Now, in keeping with August 19, another thing I wanted to bring to your attention is that it will also be our very first Fruit of the Spirit Children's Church. So children, make sure that you're here second service on August 19th. We're going to have a lot of fun. Feel free to invite your friends, bring your family, your neighbors, and the like. They will be welcome not only at Children's Church, but also they'll want to be here to get the information and resources that we'll be providing. You also have the opportunity to drop your name in the bucket to receive cool prizes such as this. Right click, Parenting Your Teenager in a Digital Media World. Sticky Faith, Guide for Your Family. Planet Middle School by Dr. Kevin Lehman. That's going to be a hilarious read. Here's a quality book, Making Children Mind Without Losing Yours. The Five Love Languages for Children and for teenagers. Folks, you are going to want to be here for August 19th. There is going to be so much fun stuff happening on that day as we unveil what the next chapter of youth and children's ministries is going to look like right here at the Worthington Church. Now, in the same breath, I also need to make a plug for this. Verified volunteers. Every volunteer that we have with our children, we need to make sure that they have completed this online program. It's a bit of an educational piece and also a background check. Now, why do we need to do something like that? Because, folks, it's important to us to keep your kiddos safe. So in order to keep them safe, this is a program that all of us, even the pastors, are doing it, and we need your help to get that done so you can help us do the fun stuff like Children's Church as well. Please feel free to see Miss Miriam for more details. I know it's in your newsletter, the bulletin. It takes just about an hour, and we'd be happy to have you complete that. Got a great worship service coming up here, folks, and I don't want to stand in the way. Here we go.
Happy Sabbath. The hymn that's listed in the bulletin is right, but the page number is wrong. It's 524, but it is, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. Would you stand with me and let's sing? Everyone with me. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word.
just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Ladies only on this verse. Come on, ladies. Everyone, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, gracious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Men only now. Yes, the sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Everyone, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Last stanza. I'm so glad I learned to trust Thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that Thou art with me, will be with me till the end. Sing it out. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Thank you. Be seated, please. It's time for our morning prayer, but there are several things that we really need to consider. School's beginning to start, and the children are coming back, and we want to pray for a wonderful school year and for to take care of the additions. And I got a call from the school principal. There's two or three children that don't have money for tuition. And in spite of all the other things we have going on, we want to keep these children in. And I committed some money. And if you think about it, talk to the principal, or either besides the Christmas club, besides the church budget, put something down for the worthy student or the students that need the money, because we want to keep these children in the school. You never know who we're dealing with here, and it brings other families in. And it so happens that these children are not from Seventh-day Adventist families, so we want to show them what we can do as far as a church, as far as the Seventh-day Adventist church. Some people think that we're one of those cults or something. Well, we believe in the cult of giving, because I know per capita Seventh-day Adventists really give a lot of money to church. And I talked to one person that said, I was telling about some of the things we're doing, said, you need to come and join our church because we don't have those problems. And I thought about that for one second. I said, no, I'm not going to leave my people. I love my folks here. Amen? Okay. So listen, let's bow our heads, and I'd like for you to just take a minute or so and say a special prayer, and they will go on from there with my prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for the Sabbath day. It's so wonderful after a busy week to be able to come aside and see the people who love you, who trust you. The faces are beautiful, Lord, and to see everyone this morning, it was just a joy to walk into church and to see the folks that are here to worship you. And Lord, we think about the school starting. Everything seems to come through our children. They are the future of the church. They're the future people that are going to be sending the message for you. And Lord, we don't know how long it's going to be before you come, but we need to cultivate these people now. Help us within our hearts to be ready to help them, to encourage them, and to help with the people that don't have the money, and that the school year will be great. Bless the new principal and the teachers. Work with them in every way, Lord. And we praise your holy name. And now, Lord, we pray for the people in our congregation, those that are ill, those that are depressed, those that have marital problems, any problems that they have, Lord, you know what they are. And I learned a long time ago that man's extremity is God's opportunity. Lord, we give you the opportunity to take care of situations that we cannot handle. It seems like we're asking all the time, but Lord, we love you, we praise you. Sometimes we don't know how to praise you, Lord, but we give you all the honor and glory this morning. Keep us in your care. Bless the rest of our service. In your precious Son's name we pray. Amen. Now, just for the offering, I want everybody to stand up, shake hands, kiss, say, I love you, whatever. Everybody talk to people here. There may be some visitors here. We want them to feel welcome. Don't forget me up here. Thank you.
I saw you got the spirit-filled brother right here.
God bless you.
I can
you.
See it in your face.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much. As you go back to your seats, those of you who have bulletins, I want you to look at that little piece of green paper in the bulletin, and it tells you about our local budget income, local budget expense, and local budget net income. And I was just at finance committee meeting. You see that last one in parentheses? We're in the hole, $28,000. And matter of fact, one member came to me this morning and said, you know, I'm going to increase my monthly giving so that we can overcome that deficit. And that's the kind of giving that we need. You know, and I just want to go aside for a second and tell you about a little scam that's going on. And I think we should inform our members. There are people that have been calling me on my cell phone about a rebate on my electric bill. And like I told one lady, I said, well, look, my father's rich. I don't need your money. And our father is rich, right? But they've called from someplace in Ohio. Then I got a call from Florida, some foreign guy. And he called me. He got a little upset. He said, look, Mr. Robert. And I don't like people calling me Mr. Robert or Mr. Bob. And if you want to know the reason why, Carolyn, I can explain it to you sometime. But he really got my ire up a little bit, and I said, look, I don't need this. Well, you were supposed to have your account number for us. I said, are you kidding? You think I carry my electric bill around with me? Well, what's happening? These people are telling people, especially older people. I told the lady, I said, I might be old, but I'm not stupid. And what they do is they take your electric bill number And some way they get into your accounts. And when I finally told the guy, look, if you call me again, I'm going to call the police with this number. 2 days later on Channel 2, someone had called the guy, what's his name? He says, bring it to 2 or whatever. She had the same thing happen to her. And some people, $100, you know, and not that I poo-poo at money, but, you know, I told one lady who thought I was going to take her purse, I said, ma'am, you don't have to hold your purse. I'll give you some money, you know, because he held her purse close to her. And I'm not arrogant or proud or anything, but you have to watch out for these people. And they seem to get with older people because they think that some people on fixed income, $100 sounds good. So kind of watch out for it, because they make all kinds of phone calls and things. Now back to the offering. We have the Christmas Club going on. This is our local budget, and they need help at the school as well. The school mortgage is going fine. And of course, we have Stepping Stones is still by that little thread hanging on. I just had finance committee meeting this week, and we talked about all these things. And if you want to hear about it, and we hear about for the whole meeting, you need to come sometimes and sit down. We need your help, folks. We really, really need your help. And I don't know what your incomes or anything like that are, but like the song says, dig a little deeper. And you remember when I sang that song a few weeks ago, any rags, same old story, same old song, any money, same old story, same old song. We need you to help us out here. Would the deacons come forward, please? These are the handsome guys. They always put me up with the ugly guys, but that's okay. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for being our Father and our God. Lord, it's so wonderful to think of spending life with you eternally. It's hard to even fix it in our minds. And Lord, I know that every little bit extra we give, it sends your message on, and we can get on up out of this place. We need to be with you because we know you're in a land of plenty, and Lord, we want to be there. Thank you for the folks that give. Thank you for the deacons. And I pray, Lord, that everyone under the sound of my voice will receive your blessing. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath.
Of sorrow, seasons of pain, when all seems hopeless, one thing remains. Our God is faithful, His word is true. He said, call on His name, and He will answer you when you pray. When you pray, He has promised He will answer when you pray. Filled with despair, just know that Jesus, He hears and answers prayers. He's ever waiting on you. You just call on His name, and He will see you through when you pray. When you pray, the Lord promised He will answer. When you pray, when you pray, you gotta do, you gotta pray. All your chains are broken through Jesus. See those demons, they tremble. They will have to flee when they hear the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus, there is victory. Tell the enemy he's defeated, and your battle is won. All your chains, they are broken through Jesus, the demons, they will tremble, they will have to flee. Name, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, church, you need to pray. Pray. He has promised He will answer. All you have to do is pray. Do you believe the Lord? All you have to do is pray, because Jesus, He will answer when you pray.
Praise God.
Amen. Can everyone hear me? All right, perfect. Thank you, Miriam, for that wonderful piece. That was very inspiring. Thank you very much. Well, good morning, church, saints. It's good to see each and every one of you this morning. I'm glad to see your smiling faces this wonderful Sabbath morning. I hope you're ready to worship the Lord this morning and to learn from His Word. But before we get into that, I just want to make another plug for our Chapter 2 launch party next week, August 19th. This is going to be a big day for our church because we are going to unveil the next chapter of youth and children's ministry here at the church. And from what I've been told from leadership, it is time to focus on our youth. Amen? Youth, young people, young adults, no longer are you going to be a side note of the church, but you're going to be part of the church. You're going to have a voice, you're going to have a say, and this is going to be your church. And it's going to be every generation's church. Amen? Amen. So next Sabbath, be here. It's going to be a great Sabbath, so you don't want to miss out. Chapter 2 Sabbath next week, August 19th. All right, let's go ahead and start with a word of prayer this morning. Father in heaven, Lord, as we come before you this morning, we ask, Lord, in a special way that you will fill this place with your Holy Spirit. Father, we ask that the distractions and the problems that we may be going through, we pray, Lord, that you will quiet those and that we will hear your voice and your voice alone this morning. And Father, may we not just hear your voice, Lord, but may we leave here changed and transformed by your Spirit. And Father, we ask that you take the words that are spoken this morning. May it be yours. And again, I ask that you hide me behind the shadow of the cross. And may your name and your name alone be glorified this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The title of our sermon this morning is Even If. Excuse me, I'm dealing with a little allergy, so I'm going to need some tissues up here. Title of the sermon is Even If. It was love at first sight. Austin was a native of South Africa, and he was there doing some mission work when he met Rebecca, who was in the middle of a 9-month trip to South Africa with the organization World Race, doing some mission work. And there in South Africa, they met. They started to get to know each other, and before long, they started dating. And 4 months later, they got married. Oh, it was the happiest day of their life. Their families were there to celebrate with them, and it was just a great day. It seemed like a happily ever after story. But less than 24 hours later, Rebecca and Austin were driving in a truck, and they lost control of the truck. They ran off the road, and it wrapped itself around a tree. Austin died on impact. Rebecca was taken to the hospital by EMTs, and she died there a few days later. Can you imagine what the parents were going through? Just 24 hours earlier, they were celebrating with their daughter and with their son, the best day of their life, and in less than 24 hours, their joy turned to tears as they mourned the death of their daughter and their son. What happens to you when tragedy strikes? What happens to you when things happen that are unexpected? What happens to you when you get that diagnosis from the doctor that says that you have cancer? What happens to you when your child is diagnosed with an illness that you don't know or you don't think you can deal with? What happens when you get that pink slip from your boss that says you are let go? What happens when the finances doesn't seem to be there and you cannot make ends meet? What happens when tragedy strikes? What happens to your faith? Do you lose your faith in the midst of tragedy, or is your faith still there? Timothy Jones was a businessman, and he was in his office one day at a board meeting. And during the board meeting, he was interrupted by an emergency phone call. As he picked up the phone, it was a doctor on the other line from Santa Monica, California. And the doctor said, Tim, you probably need to get over here because your father is not doing well. You see, Tim's father just weeks earlier had a heart attack, and he was there at the hospital, and Tim's father was getting better, and he was recovering so quickly that the hospital actually let him go back home. Well, what happened was Tim's father had another heart attack, and it was more severe than the first one, and the doctors thought that he only had hours to live. Tim ran out of his office, jumped on the soonest plane to California to see his father. And as he was there, sitting in his seat, waiting anxiously for the plane to land in California, he was thinking in his head, "Oh, I wish that I can tell my father just one more time that I love him. Just one more time." He was so anxious and so worried that he took out his journal, and there, as he was sitting on the plane, he started to write in his journal, and he wrote this prayer. He said, "Lord, keep my father alive until I get there so I can say goodbye." The plane landed. Tim ran out of the airport and he made his way to the hospital, only to be met by his mother and a family friend who said his father passed away. What happens when your prayers go unanswered? What happens when you pray for something so earnestly and you claim Bible promises and you pray, but it doesn't seem like anything is happening? What happens when the gates of heaven seem to be closed, and when you feel like your prayers are just bouncing off the walls and you feel like no one is listening to you? What happens then? What happens to your faith when God doesn't seem to answer your prayers like you wanted? You know, if we speak honestly, my friends, unfortunately, a lot of us sometimes have only if faith. We only have faith in God if He answers our prayers. We will only trust in God only if good things happen. We will only trust in God only if this or that happens. If God gives me good things, or if God provides for me financially, or God provides for my family. Only if. We might not say that out loud, but our actions definitely speak it. And the reason why I say that is because when tragedy strikes, when bad things happen, when bad situations happen and unforeseen situations happen, we blame God. Oh, we throw a hissy fit and we scream at God and say, "Why, God, why?" And our faith is shaken because of those situations. My friends, God is challenging us this morning to not have only if faith, but to have even if faith. Even if God doesn't answer. Even if things don't go the way I want. Even if it seems like things are falling apart, I will still trust in God. Today we're going to dive into a story. It's a very familiar story to you. It's found in Daniel chapter 3. And we're going to learn from three Hebrew boys how to live even if faith. So if you could take your Bibles with me, please, and turn to Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. As you turn to Daniel chapter 3, I'm going to give a little background to this story. And the chapter that precedes Daniel 3 is Daniel chapter 2. And as Adventists, we're very familiar with this chapter because it is the chapter where King Nebuchadnezzar had the dream of the statue of many metals. And we know that Daniel prayed and God revealed to him the meaning of the dream and that each metal represented a different kingdom, starting from Babylon, going down to the timeline of history to the time that Jesus comes again. And King Nebuchadnezzar was told that the head of the statue was gold, and that represented him. But you see, King Nebuchadnezzar didn't quite like that interpretation. You see, he didn't like that interpretation because the interpretation showed that his kingdom was going to come to an end. And being the proud monarch, he thought that my kingdom is going to be everlasting. And so he decided to scoff at the interpretation of the dream, and he did it by building a statue not made of different metals, but a statue made of pure gold that was about 9 stories high. He did this to show that my kingdom will last forever. And he placed it there in the middle of the plain of Dura so everyone could see that his kingdom, Babylon, would last forever. And there he thought, well, what am I going to do with this image? Do with this image of gold? Commentators tell us that around this time, King Nebuchadnezzar had just put down an insurrection in Babylon. And so there were political people involved, and he wanted to know who was really on his team. Who was really for him? Who was really against him? So he thought this image would be a perfect time, a perfect way to determine who was on his team and who were the insurrectionists. And so he decided to call all his leaders together from all the provinces to the plain of Dura, and he decided to ask them to worship this image as a pledge of allegiance to him. We read this invitation in Daniel chapter 3, verse 3. It says, so the satraps, prefects, governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the other providential officials assembled for the dedication set up, and they stood before it. All the leaders came to the plain of Dura and stood there in the shadow of that great golden image. And all the leaders would have included Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. But we probably know them better by their Babylonian names, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And there they stood at the plain of Dura. The scriptures continue in verse 4. Verse 4. It says this in Daniel 3, verse 4 through 6. Then the herald loudly proclaimed, nations and people of every language, this is what you are commanded to do. As soon as you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the pipe, and all kinds of music, you must fall down and worship the image King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship will immediately be thrown into the blazing furnace. The herald sat down. The music played. And as you scan the plain of Dura, it seemed like every person there in the sight, in your eyesight, fell and worshiped that image. Well, almost everyone, except for 3. We know the story. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stood tall. Now the question is, will they be noticed? I mean, out of the thousands of people that were there, is it possible that they would go unnoticed? Could it be that they would go unnoticed? Well, the scriptures tell us that they didn't. And in fact, there were some men, a group of people, who hated Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And it wasn't because of anything that the 3 men did to them. They hated these boys because they were foreigners, and they didn't like foreigners being on top of them in leadership. And so these spies were looking, and they saw that they didn't stand, and they decided to go and tattletale to the king. Well, the scripture tells us that the king wasn't very happy with this, and so he commanded that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego appear before him. Three men to appear. I can imagine he was thinking to himself on how disappointed he was in them. I mean, these were his best students. These were his top advisors. Could these people really be the ones who were plotting to take over his kingdom? Could these three boys really be part of the insurrection? And as Nebuchadnezzar was thinking, I'm sure he played over the scenes of how these three boys were faithful to him and how they served him and how they were kind to him and how there was nothing wrong that they did. They always did their work well and they were respected and they were trustworthy. And when these three men came before him, he decided to give them a second chance. Let's read it in Daniel chapter 3, verse 15. Daniel 3, verse 15, this is the king speaking to the three boys. Now, when you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the pipe, and all kinds of music, if you are ready to bow down and worship the image made, very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into the blazing furnace. Then what God will rescue you from my hand? You know, at Southern Adventist University, I was a junior there at Southern Adventist University, and all junior students had to take a class called Church History. And this was a famous class, not because of the content, but because of how hard it was and how hard the professor was on his students. The professor's name was Dr. Pettibone. And I dreaded this class. In fact, I loved history until I took church history. Then it kind of changed my view on at least church history. This professor was so tough that your grade was dependent on four items: 2 papers and 2 tests. That was it. So if you failed a paper, you failed the class. And you had to pass in order to graduate. Well, the dreaded time came. I took the class, and I made it through the partway through the semester, and it was time for my final paper, and I had to read a book. I believe it was on the Waldenses, and I turned it in. And then a few days later, the dreaded email came. I opened my inbox, and right there was an email from Dr. Pettibone. I opened it and it said, "Jeremy, I need to talk with you in my office. Please come to my office." I knew what that meant, that I failed the paper. And so I got out of my seat and I made the long way from the guy's dorm to Brock Hall. And usually the path or the way to the guy's dorm to Brock Hall was usually not that long. But today, this day, it took forever as I walked down the promenade making my way to Brock Hall. As I was walking, I was thinking to myself, "Man, what am I going to do? Lord, I thought you called me to the ministry. I thought you called me to the ministry, and I can't be a pastor if I don't pass this class. Lord, please don't tell me I have to take this class again. Lord, my father is going to kill me." I finally made it to Dr. Pettibone's office. I sat down in his chair, the chair, and waited for those dreaded words to come. And sure enough, he said, "Jeremy, you failed your paper. But..." Then my ears perked up. "But I'll give you a second chance. Here's what I'm going to do. Reread the book, redo the paper, and turn it in to me in the summer, and everything is going to be okay." You know, I walked out of that room, that office, screaming, shouting for joy. I know it's not good for Adventists to dance, but I was dancing a little bit in my head, okay? But I was excited, happy. Why? Dr. Pettibone gave me a second chance. And to not spoil the story, but I passed the class. I'm here, so. But Dr. Pettibone gave me a second chance. Is that how these men would respond to King Nebuchadnezzar's offer? By being grateful for a second chance? Well, let's read what the Bible has to say about that. In verse 16, Daniel 3, the word of God says, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it, and he will deliver us from your majesty's hand. But even if he does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods nor worship the image of gold you have set up. Wow. Can you imagine the guts it took to look at the greatest man in the world at that time, look him square in the face, and say, you know what, King? And you know why? Because you're not so big as you think you are, because we serve a God that's bigger than you. And by the way, he will deliver us from your puny hands. But even if he doesn't, it's not going to change our mind. We're not going to worship that idol that you put up. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the guts it took to say that? But the scriptures don't indicate that the three Hebrew boys, they didn't flinch. They didn't back down, nor did they cower in the face of the king's threat. No, they boldly proclaimed their trust in God. And they not only boldly proclaimed their trust in God, they said, we even have enough trust and faith in our God that even if he doesn't answer our prayers and save us, we're still going to trust him. My friends, they were willing to serve God. They had even if faith. They were willing to serve God even if he didn't answer their prayers, even if he didn't save them. I'm sure they didn't want to die. No one wants to die. But they said, even if we have to die, we're still going to trust in God because he's our Lord. And we're going to serve him. Even if he doesn't save us, we're going to serve him. Wow. Talk about amazing faith. Do we have that type of faith? That we can stare even into the face of death itself and say, I'm not going to let that define who I am. I'm not going to let that bother me because I trust in God. And yeah, I may die. Yes, the cancer may take my life. Yes, the divorce might happen. Yes, my child may not in my lifetime come back to the Lord. Yes, we may not be able to make things meet right now. But even in the face of that, we're going to trust in the Lord. Are you willing to say that? Let's develop this a little further. Let me ask you a question. Did Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego know that God was going to save them, yes or no? No, they didn't. We have the privilege of knowing the end of the story, so we know that God eventually saved them in the midst of the furnace. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had no idea that God was going to save them, yet they made this bold statement. So in the midst of that bold statement, they didn't know that he was going to save them. So they felt the ropes being tied around their body. Okay? They felt the heat of the flames on their face. They heard the screams of the men who died as they threw them into the furnace. But there's no hint or indication that they recanted what they said. So they talked a big talk, but they also walked the walk. They said, Lord, even if you don't save us. Now, if I was in their shoes, I probably would say the same thing, yes, but as those ropes are being tied, I'd be like, oh, this is a little tight. I wonder how God's going to get me out of this one. And as I feel the heat on my face, whoa, that's a little hot. Come on, Lord. We don't have much time now. I'm about to die. Please. And as they threw me into the furnace, but the three Hebrew boys, they thought that they were going to die. Yet they trusted in God. Yet they trusted in God. Wow. They had even if faith. They said, God, we know you can rescue us. But even if you don't, we're still going to trust you. Wow, what amazing faith. Let's develop this a little further. My friend, sometimes when we get mad at God because things don't happen the way we want, or prayers don't get answered, or unforeseen circumstances happen, and we ask God, how can you allow this to happen to me? The reason why we get mad at God is because we lose control. In this situation, we lose control. You see, we like to control things, don't we? We like to control our life. We like to plan things, and we like to be in control. We like 1 + 1 = 2. We like the promises or the times that say that when we do this, God will do this. When we be our faithful, God will bless. We like those things because we can be in control. But those times when we're not in control, when those times when bad things happen to us and we get out of and we're out of control, we are upset because we're not in control anymore, and it turns us into fear. Turns us to fear. It turns us to be anxious because we like to control things. But my friends, this morning, I want to say to us this morning, we need to let go of this desire to control things. We need to let go of this desire, this need to have to be in control of everything. Richard Foster, in his book, Celebration of Discipline, says this. And page 110, I think he hits it the nail on the head. He says this. He says, the obsession to go the way we want them to go is one of the greatest bondages in human society today. Isn't that right? I think he really hit the nail on the head. You know, we want things to go the way we want them to go. And when they don't go, we get upset. Because we like to control things. My friend, God is telling us this morning. God is telling us this morning that we should not let, when things are out of our control, we should not let fear overcome us, but we should let faith take over. When things are out of our control, when bad things happen, when unforeseen things happen, we should not be fearful. We should not worry. We should not fret, but we should trust in God. We should trust in God. This is why the Hebrew boys were able to say what they said. Because they had developed a faith, they had developed a relationship with God that was so strong that said, even if God doesn't answer our prayers, we're still going to trust Him because He has shown Himself faithful. And even if He doesn't show Himself faithful here, I'm still going to trust Him. That is why they could do that, because they had developed even if faith. They developed the faith that trusts in God even when things don't go according to our plan. My friends, Jesus never said that we would live a problem-free life. The Bible doesn't say that. And if you interpret that from the Bible, you're reading through rose-colored glasses, because the Bible doesn't say that. And in fact, Jesus says the exact opposite. He says this in John 16:33. He says, in this world you will have what? You will have trouble. But take heart, because I have overcome the world. Can I contextualize this verse for us today in the 21st century? Excuse my language, but Jesus says this life is going to suck. Right? Am I right? This life sucks sometimes, doesn't it? This is hard life, right? I've lived long enough to know that life is not all a bed of roses. Right? This life is hard. This life is tough. This life sucks sometimes. But you see, Jesus doesn't leave us there. He says, but take heart, but be encouraged. And why should we be encouraged? And He says it because I have overcome the world. Can I hear an amen? The reason why we shouldn't let circumstances dictate how we feel. The reason why when bad things happen to us, we shouldn't let of our faith, because we have a hope of a future. And we know that what we are going through now is not going to last forever. What we are going through now does not define us. My wheelchair does not define me. My walker does not define me. My age does not define me. My illness does not define me. My unemployment does not define me, because I am a child of God and I have a future. My friends, that is what God is trying to tell to us this morning, is that when things happen in our life, yes, it hurts. Yes, I know it hurts. Yes. But do not let your situation, do not let your circumstance get the best of you. Do not let it weigh you down, and do not let it rob you of your faith, because we have a future. Now, my friends, that does not mean, just because we believe that, that does not mean the pain and the hurt is going to go away. Yes, the divorce is still going to hurt. Yes, losing that family member, close friend, it's still going to hurt. Yes, losing your job is still going to hurt. Yes, there's pain. It's still going to be pain. But in the midst of our pain, my friends, in the midst of the unknown, in the midst of the unanswered questions, we can say with confidence, Lord, I don't know what you're doing, but I trust in you. I don't know what you're doing, but I trust in you. Let's see what happens to the three Hebrew boys after they were saved from the furnace. Verse 28, same chapter, verse 28, starts off and says, "Then King Nebuchadnezzar said, 'Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and rescued his servants.'" Now let's stop there for a minute. Is King Nebuchadnezzar a believer in Yahweh? No. He's a believer in other gods than Yahweh. But yet this is what he is saying. They trust in him and defied the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than to serve or worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I decree that the people of any nation or language who says anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be cut into pieces and their houses be burned into piles of rubble, for no other god can save in this way. My friends, when we have even a faith, when we go through bad circumstances, when we go through bad things, and when we strive through unanswered prayer, and we allow people to see what we're going through, and we strive through, and we decide that we're going to trust in God, people are going to notice. Unbelievers are going to notice, and God is going to be glorified. Amen? God is going to be glorified. Because that, for you to lose a Lord, that's not natural. That is supernatural. And so people are going to take notice of that and say, hey, there's something different about you. Why can you do that? And then you can say it's because of Jesus. When we have even a faith, it not only helps us, it not only grows our faith, but it tells other people about Jesus. It glorifies the Father in the process. I have a real life example of this. A few years ago, in April of 2013, my cousin passed away in a tragic motorcycle accident. This is his gravesite. He was driving his motorcycle on a Sabbath afternoon. He was known as a speed demon, but at this particular time, he wasn't speeding. What got him was someone ran a red light and hit him. So it was because someone broke the rules, the laws of the land, is because my cousin died. And there, we were at his funeral, my family and I. And I particularly noticed my aunt and my uncle, who were the parents of my cousin, Andrew. And I noticed through that situation that they still trusted in God. Did they question? Absolutely. They didn't have any answers. They were wondering why. Did they wonder what God was doing? Absolutely. But in the midst of their, in the midst of the unknown, in the midst of the questions, in the midst of that darkness time in their life, they said, God, we're still going to trust in you, though we don't know what you're doing. And it encouraged me in seeing that. Because, my friends, it is not natural for parents to bury their child. It's supposed to be the other way around. It's unnatural for parents to have to bury their children. Well, my aunt and uncle did that, and yet they trusted in God, even if we will trust in you. Now, my friends, that doesn't mean, that doesn't mean we can't be honest with God. That doesn't mean we can't be honest with God. If we look through the book of Job, Job was honest with God, wasn't he? There were some times when Job said, Lord, I don't know what you're doing up there, and I don't like what you're doing up there. Right? Job was honest. That's fine. Our God is big enough to handle those things. Our God is big enough to handle our questions. Our God is big enough to handle our doubts, my friends. Our God is big enough to handle those things. But in the midst of those things, in the midst of the questions, in the midst of the doubts, don't let go of God. That's the difference. You can question, you can doubt, you can wonder, you can be upset, you can yell at God if you want to, that's fine. But don't let go of Him. Because, my friends, it is usually in the midst of your trial that God shows up. God didn't show up before the Hebrew boys were thrown in. God showed up in the midst of the fiery furnace. God didn't show up before the lion's den. God showed up in the midst of the lion's den. God didn't show up in Peter's life before he sunk in the waves. God showed up in the midst of the waves coming over Peter. God shows up in the midst of our circumstances. And if we wait, if we just hold on just a little bit longer, God is going to show up. But that doesn't mean we can't be honest. Now you might be asking me, well, how can I develop this type of faith? How can I develop even if faith? And I think from this passage this morning, we can draw two principles on how we can develop even if faith. The first principle is have faith in God in the small things and allow Him to grow you. My friends, the faith Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had didn't happen overnight. It was a process. It was a process of trusting Him in the small things, and that grew and that developed their faith. It's the same thing with us, my friends. Rarely do we have growth that doesn't require pain and effort. Rarely do we have growth that doesn't require pain and effort. My friends, so the small things in life, like when you can't pay your bills, when you're diagnosed with that illness, when your child denies the existence of God, when your family member dies, those are the times when we can allow God to grow our faith and not give up on Him and say, even if, Lord, I don't understand, I don't know, I'm in the dark, it's the unknown, but even in my darkness, I will trust in you. And as we say that, as we practice that, our faith is going to grow stronger each and every day. When things don't happen the way we want it, when we get a flat tire and we're in a hurry to make a meeting, and we say, Lord, it is what it is. That's a growing experience. And as we grow through those experiences, our faith is going to increase. It's just like weightlifting. You can't tell right now because of how I look, but in college, I used to lift weights a lot. I used to work out a lot. And thank you for not laughing at that comment. I appreciate that. In college, I used to lift weights a lot. And as you're lifting weights, the object of you to lift, of lifting weights is that you want your muscles to tear, right? Because that's when growth happens. When your muscles tear, then they grow back stronger. So ask anyone who has lifted weights, and they will tell you that it is not a painless process. Ask them the day after they lift weights. It's not going to be painless. They're going to be sore. But as they continue to lift, and they lift bigger and bigger weights, then their muscles are going to grow stronger and stronger, right? If you lift the same weights over and over again, if you can do 10 reps three times with the same weight, you're not growing anything. You need to give heavier weights, and you need to push, and there's effort, and there's sometimes pain. But at the end of that effort and pain, there's growth, right? Same in our spiritual life. Same in our spiritual life. We need to hang in there. As God is molding us, as situations are coming, we need to hang in there and trust in God, and at the end, there's going to be growth. The second way, not only allow God to grow our faith in the small things, the second way is to surround ourselves with people who will help and encourage you. My friends, I am sure Shadrach, Meshach, or Abednego would have said the same thing if they stood alone. But I'm sure it definitely helped to have those two men beside them. I'm sure it helped them to know that I'm sure it helped Shadrach to know that Meshach and Abednego was right there standing beside him, saying the same thing he was saying. My friends, when we go through bad times, we sometimes like to isolate ourselves, right? I know I don't want to talk about it. I don't need anybody. Because we think that it shows a sign of weakness. If we need someone, we think it shows a sign of weakness. So we don't want to bother anyone. So we isolate ourselves. But my friends, that doesn't help. God never created us to live in isolation. God created us to live in community. That's why there is church. Church is supposed to be that community where we can encourage each other, where we can spur each other on, where we can uplift each other, and where we can encourage our brothers and sisters when they say, I can't go on. I can't go on. And we're there to say, yes, you can. Yes, you can. Another example of weightlifting. It is not wise at times to weightlift without a spotter. And what does a spotter do? A spotter is there to help encourage you and to help you when it gets a little tough, right? Because those last reps, if you're doing it correctly, those last reps, you're supposed to struggle. It's supposed to feel like you can't push anymore, right? It's supposed to feel like you're about to give up. And you say, no, I can't do it anymore. I can't do it anymore. And the spotter's job is to say, yes, you can. Yes, you can. Keep pushing. Keep pushing. And sometimes he puts his or her fingers on the bar and kind of, I know that they don't lift it because, yeah. But they kind of help like this, kind of gently lifting the bar, encouraging you. My friends, in our spiritual lives, we need spotters. When you're struggling with the weight of life and you say, Lord, I can't go anymore. I can't go anymore. Your spotter's there to say, yes, you can. Yes, you can. And when you feel like you can't push anymore, your spotter's there to help you. We need people in our lives to help us. If we want to develop, even if faith, we need to allow God to grow us in the small things, but we also need to surround ourselves with people who will lift us up. My friends, in closing, there's a video that I want to show. It's a song, Even If. It's by Mercy Me. And it kind of encapsulates the message for this morning. So as the video is being pulled up, I hope that you listen to the words and allow the Lord to speak to your heart. we having trouble with the video? Okay, unfortunately the video is not working this morning. But we will continue on. In closing, there's a story. Her name was Joni Erickson Tada. And Joni, shortly after high school graduation, she was hanging out with her friends, and they were at the Chesapeake Bay, and they were playing. They were swimming there at the Chesapeake Bay, and she decided to jump into the water. Well, what she didn't know was that the water was shallower than she thought. As she jumped in, she hit the bottom, and she was paralyzed from the neck down. Can you imagine? An 18-year-old young girl, with all the promise of life ahead of her, with a future, with hope, automatically it was shattered because she was paralyzed. Her family, her friends, even herself, they prayed earnestly, God, please heal me. Heal our daughter, heal our friend. But she remained paralyzed. She went through some dark times in her life. She went through such a dark time so dark that she actually asked her friend to help her commit suicide. But even in the midst of the pain, and even in the midst of the darkness, and even in the midst of the lack of the future that she was hoping, she trusted in God. And she developed her faith. And it grew stronger and stronger and stronger. And now she is an example to many people, to countless people. I don't have a picture. I have a picture of her on my PowerPoint, but that's not pulled up right now. But the picture shows her with a paintbrush in her mouth, and that's how she does art. She's a great artist, and that's how she does her art. She paints with her mouth, and she's written books, a book on her story and how she trusted in God. And she wrote this in her book, When God Weeps. She says this. It's kind of a longer quote. She says, God uses suffering to purge sin from our lives, strengthen our commitment to Him, force us to depend on grace, bind us together with other believers, produce discernment, foster sensitivity, discipline our minds, spend our time wisely, stretch our hope, cause us to know Christ better, makes us long for truth, leads us to repentance of sin, teaches us to give thanks in times of sorrow, increase our faith, and strengthen our character. My friends, Joni had even a faith. And I'm challenging you this morning, and God is asking us this morning to have even if faith. To have the type of faith that says, though He may slay me, yet will I trust Him. So do you have even if faith? Do you desire for even if faith? I know I do. And at this time, we're going to show the video.
They say sometimes you win some, sometimes you lose some. And right now I'm losing bad. I've stood on this stage night after night, reminding the broken it'll be alright. But right now, oh right now, I just easy to sing when there's nothing to bring me down. But what will I say when I'm held to the flame like I am right now? I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand, but they say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Well, good thing a little faith is all I have right now. God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be it is well with my soul. I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. I know the sorrow and I know the hurt would all go away.
Father in heaven, Lord, forgive us, Lord, when we have only had only if faith. Lord, grow us to have even if faith. Help us to trust in you no matter what, and help us to say, it is well with my soul. In the midst of uncertainty, in the midst of heartache, in the midst of pain, in the midst of loss, help us to say, it is well with my soul. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.